Hey guys, this is Anthony Morganti from anthonymorganti.com. This is episode one of a new video series I'm trying out called Basic Photography. This series is for you, the photographer that has just started out. You don't really know a lot about photography and you're looking for some basics. In this episode, I'm going to introduce some very basic composition. Now, this isn't meant to be all-inclusive. We're actually only going to be talking about three different of the so-called compositional rules. There are probably a dozen different compositional rules in photography, probably more. But we're going to talk about the three most common and the three that I feel somebody who is just starting out in photography needs to know. Now, I called them so-called compositional rules because I do not like calling them rules. To me, photography is an art form. I know many people don't feel that photography is an art form, but to me it is. And to me, an art form shouldn't have any rules. But I do think these so-called compositional rules are important. I prefer to call them suggestions. To create a balanced image, these so-called rules will really help you in that regard, and they will help you make a more appealing image. And the three that we're going to talk about today will really help you a lot, I think, create an image that is more dynamic and much more interesting. Now, the first rule we're going to be talking about is the rule of thirds. This is the most common rule and probably the first rule that most people hear about. And you'll look at this street image here, and I should add that I'm going to be showing you some of my own images. And they're going to be very mediocre images because I want to show you what's wrong with them and how they could be improved. And I think that helps you as a photographer as well, being super critical of your work and knowing what happened with that image to make it okay, but and what could be done to the image to make it better. So I have this street image. It's simply a woman crossing the street. Now, when you look at the rule of thirds, you'll see that all it is you're simply dividing the scene up into equal thirds, both horizontally and vertically. And the idea is you would like to have something that is interesting in the scene fall on one of those four lines. Optimally, you'd like the most interesting part of that scene to fall at an intersection between two of those lines. Now you could see I took this street shot of this woman crossing the street. And I have her frame so that her entire body is on the right-hand vertical line. So that is like textbook perfect. Also, I have her face going across a point of intersection right here between this horizontal line and that vertical line. Again, that's textbook perfect. But it's really just an okay shot. It's not a great shot. Well, you know, street photography is very spontaneous, so you get what you get. But probably what would have made this image a lot better is if something was interesting in the shot. I mean, basically, it's just a woman crossing the street smoking a cigarette. If there was something else interesting in the shot beside the woman, I think it would have really helped the image along. A lot of times you'd like to have something that contrasts to the woman. She's obviously a woman wearing a heavy coat, has a purse. Maybe if there was a guy in shorts and he was muscular and didn't have a shirt on or something. And often I say like a three-legged dog when I talk to my students. If there was a three-legged dog in the shot, in the background, that adds a lot of interest to the shot. And it really would add something to the scene. Now, obviously, how often do you stumble across a three-legged dog? But my idea is you want something else in there to kind of battle for your viewer's attention. You have her in the perfect rule of thirds area, but if there was somebody, something or somebody else in here that was interesting, it would have really improved the shot. Now again, street photography is so spontaneous, you really have to get lucky. Obviously wasn't lucky with this shot, but that gives you an idea of rule of thirds and practice it with your photography. Instead of framing something so it's right in the middle, I call that bullseyeing the subject. And sometimes you want to bullseye the subject. That's why I don't like calling these rules. They're suggestions. Sometimes it is a perfect balanced image to have somebody right in the middle of the image or something right in the middle of the image. But often you'd prefer not to. So practice this. Make sure you offset a little bit. Work on the rule of thirds. A lot of cameras will have a in viewfinder overlay so that you could actually frame the scene through the viewfinder and you'll see an overlay for rule of thirds. If your camera has that, turn that on and then you'll be able to really frame it perfectly. So check that out, rule of thirds. The next thing we're going to talk about is framing. Now, framing is exactly what it sounds like. You're using a frame more or less to frame the subject. Now, in this case here, I took a picture of my son's band and we kind of stumbled on this old dilapidated building and we snuck in and took some pictures. And you might not see the frame right away. Sometimes the frames could be very subtle. Sometimes they're very obvious. Sometimes you'll see an image. I often see people shooting like through a chain link fence and something inside of the link of a chain link fence is back in the middle. And that's like framing, perfect framing, right? Or they're shooting through a window outside at something. And that's like the epitome of framing right there. Now in this image here, I have this chunk of wood over here, this chunk of wood here. We have this like drop ceiling or what's left of it there. And then we have the bottom of the image. And if you look, I put these lines here to help you visualize the frame. So the frame doesn't have to be super discreet. I mean, it could be like, you know, a little more subtle, but it really helps concentrate your viewer's attention to something inside of that frame. Now, one tip I would give you is to make sure that something is inside of that frame is interesting. It's too often I see images from my students where they framed something, but it's not anything interesting at all. You really need something interesting inside of the frame. And keep in mind that your frame doesn't have to have four sides. And as I mentioned, it doesn't have to be super obvious. It could be very subtle because subliminally in people's minds, they kind of get drawn inside of these subtle frames without really realizing it. Now in this image, there is another frame that is a little more subtle and it has more than four sides. If you look at this piece of metal here, and then you go across the top along that drop ceiling there, maybe if you come even down diagonally to this line here, then down over to this line, and then across the bottom, and you'll get something like that. So you have this other kind of more subtle frame in there. So you could actually stack these frames, and it really is a strong compositional suggestion. And it helps focus your viewer's sight to where you want them to look. Now, I have these two frames in front of my subjects. You could actually have framing behind them too. And if you look behind them, you'll see that there's this wall. There's these two windows, obviously, in this wall. If I would have had Joe stand more to my left, so all four heads and shoulders were completely in front of the wall and not overlapping on the windows at all, that would have been another frame. They would have been framed from behind. So look for that as well, where you could frame people or something. It doesn't have to be people. It could be a thing, an object, or something interesting. Frame it from behind. And that really helps, you know, the composition along. It makes it look more balanced and more pleasing to look at. The whole idea of these so-called rules is it creates a balanced composition where it's comfortable for someone to view. Now, this next shot includes framing, and it's a little more subtle. The bottom of the frame is often used, or the bottom of the image is often used as the bottom of the frame. You don't necessarily need something at the bottom. But if you could get something on the other three sides, that's what I call soft framing. So I soft frame this building by having these branches of the trees overlap into the shot. So this is definitely a great form of framing that you could use, and it usually works out really well. This next shot uses a lot of different types of framing. We have the actual path itself, and around it we have these like trees and bushes, and it's framing our deer. But there's also focus framing going on here. The front of the image is blurry. Then we have the depth of field, where the deer is, a little bit in front of the deer and a little bit behind the deer is in focus. Then beyond that is out of focus. So we really kind of using focus as framing here. So keep that in mind. Utilize depth of field in an intelligent way, and you'll be able to kind of frame your subject with focus. It's subtle, and it usually works out really, really well. Now, in this image, there's also leading lines going on here. We have the path itself is helping lead us through the image. And that's another thing we're going to talk about is leading lines. There's a lot of different types of leading lines. Usually, they come from the bottom of the frame, or they emanate from the bottom of the frame. They don't have to, though. They could come from anywhere. And in this case, again, the path is going up. We also have the line here and the line here. And it helps lead the viewer through the frame. Now, how this image probably could have been better is if the deer was a little further back. That way, the viewer would have been led further through the frame, further down through the image. Then it would have, their eyesight would have resolved upon the deer. And it's important, like framing, that the leading lines resolve on something interesting. It's nice to have leading lines in a shot, but if they don't end up bringing your viewer to something that is interesting, the image won't be as good as it could have been. In this case here, we have strong framing. We have framing of the bushes, and we have focus framing, and we have some leading lines, but it could have been better. I think this image could have been better if this deer happened to be further back along the path, or I happen to be further back the other way. Either way, I think it would have improved the image. It's okay as it is, but again, think of that and keep those things in mind. Now we're going to continue on with leading lines, and we're going to look at this one, and this is obvious leading lines. You can see that this road is going, leading us through the shot. What's wrong with the shot, beside being HDR, I don't really care for HDR personally, but as you're leading us through the shot, we're not really resolving on anything interesting. It just kind of leads us through the shot nicely. And there's interesting things in the shot. There's some interesting buildings, and there's a great sky, right? Very interesting sky. But it's not really resolving. We're not really resolving on anything interesting. So that would help this shot along. Now, again, I kind of alluded to, there's a lot of different types of leading lines. The most obvious is something that comes along the bottom like this and just leads you through the image. Another type of leading line, and a very popular and powerful leading line, is what they call convergent lines. And most often railroad tracks are used for convergent lines because they just go off into the distance and they'll converge. Now, it could be a single track. If you just shot down a single track, of course, I don't recommend that you stand on railroad tracks, but if you shot down a single straight pair of rails, those two rails would converge onto each other off into the distance. In this case, I was up on a bridge and I shot down, and there's all these different lines. We have this set of railroad tracks, this one, and this one, and they're all converging off into the distance. Now again, what can make this image better? Well, we're not resolving on anything interesting. We're being led through the image beautifully by these leading lines, but it's bringing us to nothing. And it's an okay shot, but it would be a great shot if something was interesting down here. If the sun was setting right there, even if this water tower happened to be over here, I think it would have been a much better shot. Again, you get what you get, but just things to look out for. And remember, when you're using any type of these compositional rules, the whole idea of the compositional rule is you're making a balanced image. But another thing is you're helping your viewer look at the image in a specific way you want them to look at it. You're leading them through the image a specific way with leading lines, or you're framing where you want them to look. And when they do that, have a payoff. Have them look at something interesting. So this would have been much better if something was interesting right there. Another type of leading line, and a very powerful type of leading line, is a diagonal line. It's simply a line that comes from one of the four corners and goes diagonally through the frame. Now, it could be very obvious, like a road going diagonally through your scene, or it could be more subtle. In this case here, I took these images for a local veterans group, and I could have shot these tombstones straight on, but I think it's a more powerful image that I shot them diagonally, and they're going diagonally through the frame. And you could see that almost every time I took these types of shots, I did it diagonally. And I think it adds really a more dynamic to the shot, more dynamics to the scene. And it makes the scene, I think, a little more powerful. So whenever you have the opportunity to take a image and it has a line in it, be it a discrete like line like a road, or a more obtuse line, maybe like a row of gravestones, don't shoot them necessarily straight on. Shoot them so they go diagonally through the frame. Now, you could also shoot them maybe if you stood down here, if it was a very, very long row of gravestones. You shot them straight so that one row was to your left, one row was to your right, and they converged upon each other off in the distance. Now, in this case, these rows weren't super long, so converging lines wouldn't have worked for this type of scene, but the diagonal lines worked well. So, diagonal lines are super powerful, and try to keep those in mind because they really, really will help your image look much more interesting. Now, here is a diagonal line I took that same day when I was at the railroad yard. And you could see it just adds a little more power to the shot because the train is coming off from the diagonal compared to when I was shooting them straight on and they were converging off to nothing. Now, you would prefer maybe that the diagonal resolved on something interesting. That would be nice. And it could be at either end. If this shot had the engines, there's two trains here, and as I recall, they were both sitting still, or I think this one might have been barely moving. I think if the engine was like right up here, or this train's engine was here, or up in here, that it would have been a much more powerful shot because the engine is more interesting than these like lines of cars. So if you had the engine like towards the diagonal, it would have been like a starting or ending point, and then you would have been led through the scene a little more readily, and the scene would have been better. So in this case here, as I mentioned, it's a nice diagonal line, but we're not really resolving on anything that's too interesting. So if I had time and could hang out here, I'm sure I probably would have caught a train with the engine coming through here. Another thing you could try to do is remember our rule of thirds. Use the diagonal line, but get the engine in a rule of thirds point of intersection. And that would probably add quite a bit to the shot as well. So, think of, again, not just one of these so-called compositional rules. Try to use more than one together, and you'll usually have a much more interesting shot. So, this last one I'm going to show you is just something I want to mention to a lot of beginning photographers. This one here has a lot of great aspects to it. We have this meandering diagonal line. We have the pier comes off from the left here and goes meanders through the frame and goes over here, and we kind of resolve over here on the flag. But also to just to the left of the flag at a perfect rule of thirds point of intersection is this water intake out here in Lake Erie. And along the way there's some interesting things. As we're being led through the shot, we got some interesting things. Shot's okay though. What? It's got all these great compositional rules incorporated into it, and it's got, as far as technically it's done well, if I do say so myself. I mean, the focus is good and stuff like that, but it's not that great of a shot. I mean, it's okay shot. Well, it would be a much better shot if the light was a little different, if the sky was a lot better. So this is something I always try to get my beginning photographers to realize, especially a scene like this that is not far from my house. I could drive here in 15 minutes. Go back often. Look at the sky. Remember this shot. Like I took the shot just recently, and now I remember this shot. I remember exactly where I was standing. I remember how I took the shot. Someday when I have time and that sky is much more dynamic and the light is much more interesting, maybe I could catch a sunset over here. Or something like that, or maybe the moon will be over here. Like there's, as a matter of fact, currently the moon has been in the daytime skies, for where I live at least. So maybe you could catch the moon out there. Something adding that extra, like thing to the scene that makes it interesting. Maybe there'll be a three-legged dog along the path, you know what I mean? So something else to help this image along. Compositionally, it's fine, but there's still not enough there to make it a great shot. So I really implore you beginning photographers, go back to a scene over and over and over and get it under different lighting conditions and different weather conditions and different skies ultimately, and you'll really find that you'll get better shots overall. Also, don't just take one shot and leave. Try different angles. Try getting low, getting high, getting different. I call it working the scene. So don't just take one shot and think you're done. Work the scene. Try it different ways. Try putting these posts in different areas of the frame. See how it works out. It's nice now with digital photography, every snap is free. Back when I started out with film photography, every snap of the shutter wasn't free, so it cost us money, and our learning curve was a lot worse than it is today. So you could really learn a lot quicker because you could take a lot more shots. So work the scene and come back to these scenes that look good initially and see if you could make them better with better light and or better skies. So that's it for this first episode of Basic Photography. And I mentioned at the top, we're going to see, how it's going, see if people like it, and maybe I'll do a second episode. We'll see. All right. I thank everyone that watches my videos. I really do appreciate it. I'll talk to you guys soon.